This is what life would be like if Earth was twice as big. Let's start in space. For our thought experiment, we'll assume that Earth is double in every regard: mass, radius, volume, etc. This helps simplify our hypothetical super-Earth scenario and keeps the Earth from collapsing in on itself like a bad sponge cake. The Earth is also unlikely to be in the same orbit we're in today, not necessarily because of the effect of our increased mass on the Sun's pole, but because of the way we interact with other celestial bodies in our solar system. Much like you, after the rest of the party has had a few drinks, the Earth is suddenly much more attractive to everyone else in the solar system. And just like the super-Earth would nudge other orbits, they would nudge back. Jupiter is increasingly believed to have a significant effect on Earth's orbit, aiding habitability on our planet. If the Earth was twice as big and twice as hard to influence, we might not be in a position that's as beneficial to life as we find ourselves in today. But a super-Earth might be a super-death sentence for any life on Earth, too. The Moon is believed to be critical to life on Earth. Its gravitational effect on the Earth produces predictable tides, which in turn helps keep the planet's climate stable and promote the growth of life. Double the Earth's gravitational pull, and it's unlikely we'd have a moon. Shortly after impact, much of the would-be moon debris would get dragged back down toward the planet's surface. Over time, the super-Earth would pull even more of the debris down, potentially robbing the moon of the material needed to form. We could have ended up with no moon at all, or with a moon a fraction of the size of the one we have today. Life on Earth would have been significantly affected, and probably not for the better. But there's an even bigger problem for the super-Earth than not having a moon. Doubling all the parameters of the planet means doubling the amount of material it contains. Specifically, that would mean doubling of radioactive elements on our planet. But no, this wouldn't mean everyone gets cancer-based superpowers. Instead, the decay of all those radioactive elements would further heat up our planet's core and mantle, leading to greatly increased volcanic activity from an abundance of magma beneath the crust. The Siberian Trap is a massive volcanic rock region stretching across northern Russia. Sometime around 250 million years ago, a massive plume of lava began to rise from the interior of the planet until reaching the crust. This resulted in an explosion of volcanic activity, which lasted for about 2 million years, and it's possibly responsible for the Permian-Triassic mass extinction event. All that volcanism released massive amounts of sulfur dioxide and carbon dioxide into the atmosphere, which led to massive global warming and the acidification of the oceans. Atmospheric carbon dioxide skyrocketed from an average of 400 parts per million to a whopping 2,500 parts per million. In case you're wondering, today we're still sitting around 420 parts per million. Estimates say that the oceans at the equator could have reached as hot as a scorching 104 degrees Freedom units, or 40 degrees Celsius. Also known as the Great Dying, the Siberian Trap's disaster led to the extinction of an estimated 81% of all marine animals and 70% of land vertebrates. It's more difficult to gauge how many invertebrates died off due to the difficulty of finding fossilized remains. With a much hotter core, super-Earth would likely experience disasters like the Siberian Traps more frequently. But even just increased volcanism could prove difficult for life as we know it. When volcanoes blow their top, they can let off incredible amounts of greenhouse gases, so it's likely that our super-Earth would be much hotter than our normal Earth at this same stage in its evolution. Global temperatures could range from just a few degrees hotter to 10 or more, severely impacting how life would have evolved, and putting into doubt the ability for intelligent life to arise and/or prosper. The atmosphere itself would also make life problematic. With a doubling of gravity, atmospheric pressure would be much greater than we're used to. The boiling point of water would be higher, and convection currents would be much closer to the ground. That means that the fluffy white clouds you're used to seeing today would be significantly closer to ground level, and that storms would have much more energy. All of that extra ocean would also allow devastating hurricanes to gain more steam over warm water, and Category 5 hurricanes would be the norm rather than the exception. Another feature of super-Earth directly impacting the evolution of life would be the terrain itself. With a doubling of gravity, super-Earth would have much smaller mountains and much flatter terrain. This would further compound the wind issue, as anyone from the Great Plains states of America can attest to. In fact, super-Earth might be so windy that life might prefer flight over living on land. But that's just speculation. For fans of majestic views, though, super-Earth would be a disappointment due to a lack of mountains. And those mountains that did exist would be much smaller than the ones we know today. Super-Earth could be more arid than normal Earth, mountains often serve to stop cloud formations, forcing them to condense in one area until they inevitably release enough snow or rain to become light enough to float over them. This in turn leads to the creation of rivers that feed life all over the planet. With much lower mountains, this natural process may not be as common on Super Earth, leaving much of the planet barren from a lack of rainfall. Life may thrive only in pockets of the planet, with the rest made up of barren grasslands or deserts, where life specialized to survive off little rainfall might live. Trees, for example, would not grow as tall, as a tree can only grow as tall as it's economical for them to do in terms of energy. Trees and plants would therefore likely grow horizontally rather than vertically. In order to keep themselves upright, plants would also grow thicker, more fibrous stems. Flowers would probably still exist, if not be even more common due to an explosion of flying life forms and the denser atmosphere, but they would bud from thick, tough, fibrous plants, killing the notion entirely of delicate as a flower. There's no room on Super Earth for daintiness. Flowers here would be tough and robust, with a greater propensity for airborne life. Plants that feast on flying insects like pitcher plants and carnivorous plants would be far more common, though they wouldn't be limited to insects. Plants would evolve to feed on a greater amount of birds too, which might serve as another evolutionary pressure for birds to grow bigger, or maybe just smarter. So where do humans fit in this stinky, armor-plated, giant insect-filled hellscape of a planet? The evolution of humanity is a serious question on Super Earth, at least in the way that it resembles what we look like today. With short, squat trees, mammals would find little benefit in becoming arboreal species. So the evolution of monkeys is unlikely. Assuming humans existed at all, cities would look very different from today. Rather than build skyscrapers, we would build outwards, dramatically reducing urban density and how many people could be housed in one geographic location. The good news is traffic would be dramatically reduced due to less urban density. But the bad news is that cities would sprawl outwards like an asphalt blight on the face of the planet, paving over untold amounts of wilderness. You can forget about roller coasters or water parks. The threat of serious injury would be far too great in the Super Earth's increased gravity. Most roller coasters we have on real Earth today would be death sentences on Super Earth, and rides that like to send their passengers plummeting in free fall would be impossible. Cars would need to be built sturdier, adding to the fuel burden that double gravity would already create. The fuel mileage of the average car would be atrocious, which could have dramatic effects on how society develops. If cars are only getting a quarter of the mileage they have gotten on real Earth, then Super Earth humans would have to go through much more of their planet's oil reserves faster than we have. Granted, their planet is twice as big, so things might even out. Except when it comes to carbon emissions, Super Earth machines would require far more fuel to work and produce exponentially more greenhouse emissions than regular Earth. With an already warmer atmosphere due to increased volcanic activity, the Super Earth's man-made climate crisis could arrive far sooner than our own has and be much more deadly. Speed limits, however, would have to be strictly enforced, as crashes would be far deadlier on Super Earth than on regular Earth. Airplanes on Super Earth would not be impossible, simply far more difficult to operate. The development of flight would be significantly delayed until the creation of more powerful internal combustion engines than in our own timeline, though again, once aloft, they would have an easier time staying there. It's a toss-up between how much more efficient flying would be in a thicker atmosphere and how hard it would be to keep huge amounts of tonnage safely in the sky. The one barrier to flight might just be the landing, which might prove too dangerous to even attempt in the first place. Aircraft might be limited to operating near large bodies of water, where they can enjoy a more cushioned landing, and even then only when conditions are calm. The difficulties of living on Super Earth, insects the size of Rottweilers, heavy gravity, frequent superstorms, and constant volcanic activity might just be the impetus for Super Earth's humanity to leave their planet faster than us. After all, if where you live kinda sucks, you're probably going to be much more motivated to find a way to somewhere more comfortable. Now go check out What If the Earth Stopped Spinning? Or click this other video instead.